A chair is still a chair, even when there's no one sitting there. A room is still a room, even when there's nothing there but gloom. But a room is not a house, and a house is not a home, when the two of us are far apart and one of us has a broken heart. Now and then I call your name, and suddenly your face appears. But it's just a crazy game. When it ends in tears. Darling, have a heart. Don't let one mistake keep us apart. I'm not meant to live alone. Turn this house into a home. When I climb the stairs and turn the key, oh, please be there, still in love with.
Polly Adler, and I'm the madam of a brothel. From the parlor of my house, I had a backstage view of the underworld, the half-world, and the high. If I'd had all history to choose from, I could have hardly have picked a better time to be a madam. In the world of the 20s and 30s, the only unforgivable sin was to be poor. The philosophy of the day was anything which is economically right is morally right. And my story seems inseparable from the story of the era.
Polly, Casey Booth's on the phone.
Frank, Tom, I'll call him back in a minute, huh? The phone call I had waited for all my life. But as always, life seems somehow to make the decisions for me. We're born, we die, and we spend a little time in between. And tonight, Brooklyn seemed light years away. I'd arrived there as a child, from Yano, a little town near the Polish border. My father sent me alone in the steerage to the Golden Medina, America, the Golden Land, to live with cousins. At 14, I went to work in a sweatshop to pay for my keep. Before I knew it, my childhood was gone. I was a young woman, and I was still looking for the golden future. That never seemed to differ from the bleak present.
Buttonholes. For a week, they had me on buttonholes. With hands the size of mine, I hardly turned out enough to make money to eat.
Lara, stop daydreaming. You're falling behind.
She's tired. You know she works like a dog in this place? Well, he sits in school.
Huh. Harold doesn't just sit in school, Sidonia. Studying to be a registered pharmacist is hard work and very tiring on the mind.
Someday I'm going to go to night school myself.
So So? What's the matter with right now?
The matter with right now is we gotta work so late to turn out enough pieces. You know, last week I made $5.10. $3 a week board and room. $1.30 for lunches and carfare. That leaves a big 80 cents for shoes, clothes, and everything else. I don't know. I guess my night school just has to wait.
I'd rather be ignorant.
Yeah, dummy! Dummy! Dumb! Dumb! Dummy! Dumb!
Hey, look who's coming. It's the new foreman.
He's so handsome, he makes me nervous.
Same type as my hero.
One type's as good as another. Well, what happened?
Job, you're a natural born dancer.
Oh, thanks.
You hardly seem to touch the floor like you're floating.
That's how I feel, like I'm floating. Oh, I hope it never gets late tonight.
Like me a little bit?
Oh, I like you a lot, Mr.
Bernie. What do you say when we leave here, we drop in and speak and have a cup of drinks?
Oh, that would be delightful.
Hand me the rouge, will you?
Yes.
Thanks. Mine's one of those close dancers. He's got more hands than an octopus. I asked him, are we dancing or are you giving me a massage?
Close? If my dance is any closer, he won't need me anymore tonight.
Yeah. Oh, listen, did you ask him about taking us to chop suey?
Yeah. He said no tiki, no washi. We get the chop suey afterward.
There are only two kinds of men. Those who eat before and those who eat after.
You mean you haven't met the other kind yet?
Huh?
Hey, you want to sit down?
Well, I didn't bring my stuff tonight.
Well, here, sit down. Help yourself.
All right, thanks.
I don't know why I'm going through all this trouble. I don't think his eyes have reached my face yet.
You know, you're going to choke yourself to death.
I guess I should have mentioned I never used this stuff before.
Yeah, you keep that up, you walk out of here looking like a Halloween bag.
Here, let me help you. First, you take the powder just lightly. So, see? The white makes your eyes stand out. I'm Lorraine Sitkin. This is Madge Donnelly.
Hello, Lorraine.
Hi.
How do you do?
Hi.
I'm Polly Adler.
There, Polly. Now, just a little bit of rouge to put some roses in your cheeks. There. See? Now you're a femme fatale.
You know, it does make a difference. Thanks.
Oh, thanks very much.
Now watch his eyes pop when he sees it.
The only thing that pops with my guys is buttons.
Yeah. Hope we see you again, Polly.
Yeah, I hope so.
Bye, Polly.
Bye.
Good huh?
No.
Come on. First time in a speak, first drink. Let's drop the innocent stuff, huh?
Oh, but it's true. Honest, Bernie, it is.
I like that. That's good.
No, no! I want to go home!
Listen, I could have had any one of 30 girls in the shop and I picked you. You like your job, don't you? You'd be good to Bernie, real.
Where have you been? Where have you been? What's happened to you? Look at your clothes. What's on your face? Paint, you've got yourself all painted up. And you've been drinking. What else have you done, Polly?
Can't you see it for yourself? Does she have to draw a picture?
Max, it was my fault.
So, this is how you've been spending every night at the library. Look at her, nothing but a tramp, the hardworking one who only wanted an education, huh?
I was raped.
And how many times have you been raped before? Tell me that. How many times?
He made me do it. He made me. Honest.
She maybe pulled the wool over your eyes, but not mine. She's not fit to live with decent people.
Sarah, you gotta believe me.
I won't let her stay in the same house with my children. Is that clear enough for you? I want her out. Out!
Sarah! Go back to sleep already. Go back to sleep. But what'll happen to me? Where can I go?
Polly.
What can I do?
Look, this guy is a ward healer. He's not an employment agency, you understand? I can't guarantee. Come with me. You stay here. Mr. Rafferty, this is my sister, Sidonia.
How do you do?
She needs a favor.
Well, Harry, I come here to eat. You want to talk business, come down to the political club.
Well, this is awful urgent, Mr. Rafferty. It's something that can't wait.
Why is it nothing can ever wait? All right, what can't wait this time?
Well, you see that girl, my friend, Polly Adler? She's got terrible trouble, and she needs a job, and she's got no one to turn to.
Adler? I got no Adler in my district.
Well, she's from Brooklyn.
Brooklyn? So? Why don't you go to the district captain in Brooklyn and ask him for a job?
If you don't help her, I'm afraid she'll be in the streets without a roof over her head.
What's the matter where you live?
Where would I put her, Mr. Rafferty? My wife's expecting another kid in 2 weeks. I'm lucky I can put her up.
Look, Harry, you want to take my advice? Forget it. Send her down to welfare at Borough Hall and forget the whole thing.
Wait a minute, Harry. You vouch for her, Harry?
Well, my sister says she's okay.
Call her over. There's one thing about you, Rafferty. You're all heart.
This is Mr. Costigan.
Some guy make a sucker out of you, kid?
I didn't say a thing. I didn't say a thing.
Take it easy. Take it easy. There's always a guy in the story. Don't make it into a mountain. You're not the first. You won't be the last. You're shaking. You that scared? Got no place to live? No money? Can you talk? English? I got a place just off 3rd Avenue. Only use it now and then. She's welcome till she gets a job. She gets out a few hours when I need it.
Oh, we understand. She'll really appreciate that, won't you, Polly? This'll be a lifesaver.
Here's the address. Explain the setup to her. The janitor will let her in.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Costigan.
Thank you.
Wait a minute, Harry.
Yes, Mr. Rafferty.
Bring me some more garlic bread.
I found out later Frank Costigan was a bootlegger. He kept the apartment because he was having an affair with a married woman. I never imagined living in such luxury. Frank would use the place a couple of nights a week, and while he was with his girl, I would go to the Nonpareil dance hall.
Oh, hello, Frank.
Hi, Polly.
Oh, you're a little early.
Hey, that's quite a dress.
Oh, you like it?
Yeah. Hey, get lost for a few hours, huh? About 10:30. Take in a movie or something.
Oh, $5. Frank, that's a whole week's work. Ooh. Listen, there's salami in the icebox and bread and beer if you want.
Fine, thanks. Now, you better get a move on. She'll be here any minute.
Okay.
Don't forget, not before 10:30.
Okay. 10:30. Thanks.
Polly, what does Frank's girlfriend look like?
If I knew, I wouldn't tell you, and I never met her. Well, my brother Harry told me that she's married to a big, rich dress manufacturer.
Must you be such a gossip?
Well, I guess what her husband doesn't know won't hurt him. Polly. Paul, can I ask you a very personal question?
The answer is Frank has never put a finger on me.
He's in love with her.
Oh, you don't have to step on my foot.
Wow, now that's my idea of what a man should look like. I never saw him before. He must be new at the orchestra.
That's you he's smiling at.
Yeah, I know. Look at Laura. She doesn't seem to be having a very good time. Come on, Paul.
Laura, what's the matter?
Oh, I don't want to seem ungrateful, Polly. It was very nice of you to bring Sidonia and me here, but I think I should go home. I don't think Carol would like the idea.
Oh, what's the harm? He's too busy studying to take you out at night. A little fun never hurt anybody.
Yeah, try a dance.
Come on. I'll leave.
Hi, Polly.
Oh, hiya, Lorraine. Hello, Matt.
Hiya, Polly. Wow, it sure doesn't look encouraging.
You know, they must be having an ugly contest for the men tonight.
May I have the pleasure of this dance?
Ooh, I'm sorry. I have a pinched nerve.
Oh.
You know, I got a feeling we're going to strike out tonight. I don't think one of these guys has the price of a hamburger.
No, you said it. Come on, let's go on a treasure hunt. There must be somebody here who could buy us a dinner.
Well, see you later, Polly.
Bye, Polly.
Yeah, I'll see you.
Well, if it isn't the little wildcat. I've been asking myself, whatever happened to the little wildcat?
You leave me alone.
Not going to forget old times, are you? We're good friends, you and me.
Oh, you got your nerve. Let me go. Get your hands on me. Let me go.
Well, let's just say he didn't hear you.
Maybe he's dead.
Beat it, bugle boy. There's none of your business.
He's not dead. Maybe he's just dumb. Oh, boy.
Break up this place. I hired you to play a horn, not beat up on patrons.
He was reaching for something and slipped.
You're fired.
Oh, no, you don't understand what happened. You see, he was trying to help me.
Don't bother. I've got 3 days' salary coming.
Won't even pay for the damages. Now get out.
Oh, mister, I'm awfully sorry. It's all my fault. If you hadn't tried to help me, you wouldn't lose your job.
Don't give it a second thought. You must be fate.
Who?
Fate. That's what you are, fate. Somewhere there's a better job waiting for me. Nothing happens by accident. So if it weren't for you, I'd still be working in that cheap band. See? Excuse me, I better pack up my horn before the manager grabs it.
Well, thanks very much for coming to my aid. I'm very indebted to you.
Fate.
Will you look at this?
Wow, it's nice to know how the other half lives.
Oh, this is really scrumptious.
Lorraine, come look. She's got a bedroom all to herself.
Oh, you know, I can afford a rooming house since I got the job with the ladies' dresses, but I just can't bear to leave here.
You know, Polly, there's 11 in my family. We don't even have half this much room.
Wait, I'll show you the kitchen. Come here.
This is the way to
live. Hey, look, she's got her own tub. She don't even have to go down the hall to take a bath. Some gorgeous.
Hey, Polly. This is what I call luxury.
Frank sounds just like the kind of guy I'd like to meet. How about it, huh?
I don't know. It might be arranged.
Boy, the Speed's giving it away for chop suey.
Oh, no. No, Frank's not like that.
What, you mean to say he pays for all this and you don't even have to sleep with him?
Absolutely not. Frank is a very nice guy.
So what? Nice guys sleep with girls.
Sometime later, Frank's romance went on the rocks. Since Lorraine had expressed such a desire to meet him, I just arranged a date.
Well, here she is.
Frank? This is the girl I told you about. This is Lorraine Sitka, Frank Costigan.
Lorraine?
Frank?
Sit down, please. This is a real pleasure.
I'm delighted to meet you, Frank.
This is the first long shot that's come home for me in years. I didn't expect you to look like this. Polly, you got taste. She's a knockout.
Thanks.
That goes double for me, too, Polly. He's even more distinguished looking than you said.
I told you. It's just my type.
Harry, first bring us another setup, then the works. Antipasto, lasagna, steak brisola, rigatoni. Tell Vito to cook the rigatoni fresh.
Nothing but the best, Mr. Costigan.
Well, do you know any more girls as good-looking as Lorraine?
Frank.
Don't worry, honey. It has nothing to do with you and me. How about it, Paul?
Well, yeah, sure. There are a lot of pretty girls at the dance hall we go to. But why?
I'll tell you what. I've got some friends, a business deal, one I'd like to make. I want to throw a party at the apartment. Round up some good lookers like Lorraine here, huh?
Oh, a party, sure.
To the party.
The party.
Polly, don't come back to the apartment till after 10:30 tonight.
Okie dokie.
Harry, hurry up with that antipasto. We haven't got all night.
You bet, Mr. Costigan.
Frank? Frank?
Me, Polly. Waited for you. I want you to take this.
What for?
Frank told me to buy myself something, and I want to split it with you.
Oh, no, no. I wouldn't think of it.
Come on, don't be a dummy. There's enough here for two of us.
Buy yourself a new dress for the party, huh?
I could use a new dress. I'll take it.
Shut up.
Thanks, Lorraine.
Good night.
Good night.
Polly, walk like Theda Bear, huh?
Polly, do Theda Bear.
37
for me.
37.
Quiet, 38.
I bet, not 39.
39.
40.
What do you got, a
car? 40, the man says.
20
or 40. All right. All bets down.
All
bets. No more betting, Rod.
Come on.
Now, Red.
Come on, Red.
Hey, Red, come over here.
The winner is 39.
39. What do you got on under that dress?
What do you mean? Haven't got anything under this dress.
That 39 is all you?
You're darn right it is. All me.
I'm glad to hear it. 39, you stick close to me because you're with me from now on.
Enjoying yourself, Angelo?
Nicest bunch of little minks I've seen in a long time. Frank, I like the way you think. What's it going to run on a business unless you could have some fun while you're doing it, eh?
I agree. Have fun. We'll talk business tomorrow.
Now, we did all the talking I need. You use your head to sell me. You use your head to sell my liquor. You get 5 truckloads a week to start. On a handshake, 5 truckloads a week.
On a handshake, 5 truckloads a week.
39, what do you say we go out and have some fun, huh? Like my hotel. Fix up my brother, will you, Frank? Hey, fellas, anybody needs me, they leave a message.
Okay, that's all right.
Hey, Frank.
Yeah,
Frank.
My brother Angelo. Here's the smartest deal you ever made me, Frank.
Go ahead, Vince. Take your pick. Anyone you like.
I will.
Polly, you did a great job. Just what I needed.
Thanks, Frank. Listen, did you make the deal?
Made the deal.
Huh.
Now here. This is for the girls. And this is for you.
All this for me? Frank, this is more than a month's salary.
It's all yours. You earned it. From now on, Polly, I'm going to do some real entertaining.
That was it. As casual as that. The beginning of my career as a madam. Money Frank kept giving me, I got my own apartment, uptown on the west side. To me, it wasn't a question of morals, but of economics. Did I want easy work in a lovely apartment or factory work in a hole on Second Avenue? As far as I was concerned, the golden land was uptown. Of course, I didn't look upon it as my permanent career then. Anyway, I didn't invent sex. I was just giving it a helping hand.
Just what I wanted all my life!
Oh, Polly, I never would have believed I'd ever have such wonderful things.
Oh, Madge, I still can't believe it. Oh.
The merchandise that I sell, you only find in the best shops in town. Tell me what you want. I get it. Nobody beats my prices, and you know nobody gives better service.
Charlie, wait a minute. Just one question. Is this stuff hot?
Now, what kind of a question is that? Of course the stuff isn't hot. But with that particular garment, I wouldn't walk into Saks Fifth Avenue.
In a short time, Frank had become one of the biggest bootleggers in the city, and we made the first of what was subsequently to become our celebrated entrances into the New York nightclubs. We could not have attracted more attention if we were the floor show. The public imagines the prostitute comes in 2 standard models. Either she arrives in the world equipped with black lace stockings, sexy leer, the heart of gold optional, or else she's the poor, shabby victim of white slavers. But my girls were chosen for their beauty, manners, and taste. Play.
Isn't that the trumpet player from the Nonpareil?
Oh, yes, it is.
I love my baby. My baby loves me. Don't know nobody as happy as we. She's only 20 and I'm 21. We never worry, we're just just having fun. Sometimes we quarrel, and maybe we fight. But then we...
Frank, I've been meaning to phone you. Yeah, I've produced a lot of shows, Frank. But this is the greatest book I've ever had. And the score. Wait till you hear the score. I can guarantee you we'll have at least 3 hit songs.
That last little turkey you got me to invest in never got out of Boston.
Straight drama, that was the trouble. Nearly killed me.
Well, that's the way it goes. First your money, then your clothes.
Musicals are my forte. I'm going to stick with them from now on.
What have you got open?
Only a few units. I can let you have 2 at $5,000 apiece.
Sometimes we quarrel, and maybe we fight. But then we make up the rest of the night.
I've got one of the Schubert theaters lined up. My casting director is scouring the town for fresh talent. Frank, we got to find the best. Only the best for this show.
All right, put me down.
Good. Good to have you aboard. We got to have a winner this time, Frank. Take my word for it.
Frank, if he's looking for fresh talent, what about that young fellow there?
Each one is a smack. But you should hear him when I give him back.
I got singers like that camped in my waiting room all day.
Well, maybe you ought to move your desk to your waiting room. I think he's marvelous.
You know him, Paul?
Frank, he once did a big favor for me.
Yeah? You hear that? Did our little friend a favor. We ought to do something about that.
Sure. As a matter of fact, he's very good. Very good.
Of course he's good. Look who recommended him. Do you know who this is?
I'm sorry, I didn't have the pleasure.
Well, then meet Polly Adler, the best little casting director in this whole damn town. Well, Superintendent, congratulations. You've come up in the world, Rafferty. I always knew you had it in you.
All right, Frank, no wisecracks, huh? The sewer department suits me just fine. Besides, I'm in no mood. This cold is killing me.
Well, I always said they couldn't hold a vote getter like you down. You keep it up, someday you might be head of sanitation.
Very funny. Let me tell you something, wise guy. For your information, this happens to be one of the softest political plums in this town. All profit, no loss. Why, there's ways of picking up extra change in his job that even I don't know yet. Boy, I should be home in bed. Now, what, did you come here to needle me or to talk business?
I got word from Charlie Lucky.
Lucky Luciano?
He wants a meet with Tim Harrigan.
Oh? I don't know. You're talking about one of the top men at Tammany Hall.
That's right. You get to meet together, there's a pocket full for you.
Huh? That's kind of risky. Where could they get together? An office? A restaurant? A home? It's too risky. Too many eyes. Big Tim can't be seen talking to Lucky Luciano.
Polly Adler's. What better place to meet by accident than in a house of joy?
And you say there's a pocket full?
Wear your overcoat.
All right, I'll call Big Tim.
Hey, Rafferty. You better stay out of those sewers.
The prostitute lives in the present with little or no thought to the future. She deludes herself into believing that her profession is temporary and that eventually she will abandon the primrose path. But few ever do. Their self-imposed trap created a sense of camaraderie among my girls. Now and then there would be petty quarrels, but in general they got along together pretty well.
Yes, Vicky?
There's a Casey Booth on the telephone.
Oh. Booth? I don't know any Booth. Hello?
Miss Adler.
Yes?
This is Casey Booth.
I'm sorry, I don't know any Casey Booth.
How come I've got you to thank for the audition? The producer said that
You put the pitch in for me.
Oh, the Bell Tavern.
I'm the boy. What's the story?
Well, do you remember the nonpareil dance hall?
Yeah.
Well, I'm Fate.
You? Well, how do you like that? What did I tell you? You're my luck. You know, I got the job.
Well, congratulations. How did you get my number?
The producer of my show got it for me. Why?
Nothing. Well, I'm very glad it all worked out for you, Casey. I wish you success. It was very nice of you to call. Goodbye.
Now, wait a minute. Not so fast. You got me into this. What if I fall on my face? Suppose I explain it all to you over dinner tonight.
No, I can't do that.
Supper tomorrow.
No, I'm sorry.
Lunch Thursday.
Thank you, but no.
I'll keep going. You can't be busy the rest of your life. I can be an awful pest.
Yeah, I bet you could be. All right, I tell you what. Dinner Friday.
Where do you live? I'll pick you up.
I think it would be better if I met you. What about the Plaza? 7 o'clock in the lobby.
The Plaza, Friday at 7.
All right. Bye.
See you, Fate.
Do you always live this fast?
Gotta move fast. Crowd it all in. You're born, you die, and you spend a little time in between.
Yeah, but you gotta crowd it all into one night.
You see that second?
Huh.
It just passed. You'll never see it again. Anybody who wasted that second is a sucker. Look around outside. What do you see?
It sort of looks like Central Park.
People, millions of people, all wasting seconds, minutes, hours. Life is passing them by, and they don't even know it.
Why don't you tell them about it?
Friends, New Yorkers, countrymen, lend me your ears.
Casey, what are you, some kind of a nut? You know, if we ride around in this cab much longer, you're going to be bankrupt.
Hey, cabbie, how much do I owe you so far?
$14.50.
When it reaches 17 bucks, stop.
Right.
Casey, I bet that you spent every single cent you have tonight.
Money's a medium of exchange. You exchange it for what you want.
Oh?
If what you want makes you happy. I say if it makes you happy to be happy, be happy.
You're a crazy Irishman. Don't you ever worry about security, the future, you know, nothing?
You know, just the other day, a friend of mine asked me the same thing. He said, Casey, how come you never worry? You don't hold down a job long. You've got no bank account. You don't give a damn about anything. Don't you ever worry about what's going to become you? I said, Joe, have you ever seen me on a Thursday between 2 and 3 in the afternoon? Think, I said, did you ever see me on Broadway or in a speak or in a steam room or any place on Thursday between 2 and 3 in the afternoon? No, he said. Come to think of it, I haven't. I'll tell you why, I said. Because every Thursday, exactly at 2 o'clock, no matter what I'm doing or where I am, I drop everything. I go to my hotel room and lock the door. I take off my coat, open my collar, and sit in front of the mirror. Then I look at myself, and I worry. I say to myself, Casey, you don't hold a job long, you've got no bank account, you don't give a damn about anything. I just worry like hell. But then, 3 o'clock sharp, I put on my coat and leave the hotel. See, that way I do all my worrying on Thursday between 2 and 3 in the afternoon.
Oh, you're impossible. You're still a little boy. Oh, this is where I live. I'd invite you up, but I live with a couple of other girls.
See you soon, Polly.
Casey, I'm going out of town for a while.
I'm sorry, I'll be tied up with rehearsals for a few weeks anyway.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Good night.
Fine. You have a good time?
Marvelous.
Let me get it for you. Does he know? Something, Polly? If anybody had ever told me that one day I'd be a whore, I never would have believed it. No woman is born a whore, and any woman may become one. But even the men longest on book learning failed to understand what Kipling meant when he wrote, "The Colonel's Lady and Judy O'Grady are sisters under the skin." Could Casey Booth understand? I wasn't going to put the poor guy to the test.
Polly, the police are here.
Polly Adler?
Yes, I am.
There she is, boys. The queen bee herself. Well, that's an inside joke. Whenever we take anybody in like you, we call it a glamour pinch.
On what grounds, Sergeant?
Did you hear that, boys? What grounds? As if running a cat house isn't grounds enough for arrest.
You don't see any men around here.
So we'll take a little John Doe out of our hats. You got a lot to learn, Queen Bee. You see, when the charge is procuring for immoral purposes, the frame is as good for a pinch as the real thing. Ooh, that's good stuff. But this is your lucky day, Queen. This isn't a raid, not this time. Besides, our precinct has filled its quota for the month.
Oh, that's good.
So I'm glad to meet you and your cousins.
Nice to meet you.
I would like to drop around and get to know the people in our precinct.
That's good. Drop in any time.
Oh, by the way, I almost forgot the captain's Christmas fund.
Christmas fun in July?
We're taking contributions earlier this year.
Oh, yes. The captain's Christmas fun. For the captain?
And the lieutenant. Quarter or no quarter, if we hurt the lieutenant's feelings, I'm able to take you and your cousins for a ride in the Black Mariah.
Well, you put this under the tree for the lieutenant.
And then there's me.
Now, we can't forget about little old you, can we?
Thank you.
Are you sure that's enough?
It'll do for now. Besides, Christmas is a long way off, you know.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, my name is Sergeant Reardon, but all the queen bees in the precinct call me John.
Oh, after the toilet fixture, the same name, I presume.
Good evening.
Good evening, Frank.
Polly, meet Charlie Luciano.
Oh, good evening, Mr. Luciano.
Oh, see our friend Harrigan is well surrounded. Take good care of him, Polly. It's important to me.
It isn't easy, Frank. He likes them big and of all nationalities. Tonight he's on a Swedish kick. Suppose he suddenly wants a 6-foot Japanese girl.
Well, you've got your problems. I've got mine.
As long as you dames got the right to vote, we can keep Jimmy Walker in office. Now, he's a personality, this guy, a real personality. Last week, this dame came in. You know, Queen Maria Romania? Well, Her Majesty and His Honor, riding up Broadway in a welcoming parade. And all of a sudden, some guy in the crowd yells out, Hey, Jim, what's the matter? Haven't you made her yet?
What's the matter, Jimmy? Ain't you made her yet? Does that scare you? Hey, you're terrific.
Very good. This is Mr. Luciano.
Glad to know you.
Let's go someplace we can talk.
Okay.
Frank, why don't you use my room?
Keep this warm for me, will you?
Okay, you. And relax, Cheryl.
All right. What's this all about?
We'll get right to the point, Harrigan. We know that Tammany Hall is considering putting up Bill O'Brien or Tom London as its candidate for district attorney. If O'Brien is the candidate, Lucky will contribute substantially to the campaign.
Where did you find out who Tammany's putting up for DA?
We got our ways of finding out these things, Mr. Harrigan.
Oh, I see. What do you get for your money?
My organization is active on the city docks. We heard the shipowners are unhappy about this. Mr. O'Brien is a man a person can talk to just in case of some trouble.
I don't know how the boys down at the hall are going to take this. With you in it, your name, kind of risky. Could be a leak.
The way we do business, there won't be any leak.
We got tough opposition this year. We don't want to take any chances.
What Charlie hasn't said is if his offer is turned down by you, he'll donate the money to your opposition.
Oh, come on, who are you kidding? The Fusion Party wouldn't play ball with him even if he did.
Nobody would expect it. See, the contribution would be made anonymously from some civic-minded citizen. Harrigan, look, everybody knows they've got a better candidate than you can put up. All they need to beat you is money. That way we'd both lose.
You know better than to use strong-arm methods on us. Nobody pushes us around.
We don't know what you mean by strong-arm methods. Let's just call it good politics.
This contribution, what do you call substantial?
A blank check in small bills.
I don't know. The committee meets in a couple of weeks, and I can't promise you anything.
That's good enough for me, Mr. Harrigan. You let me know.
I'll let you know.
Harrigan, it's a pleasure doing business.
Yeah, sure.
Mr. Harrigan?
Yeah?
This is Greta Svensson. She's just arrived.
Oh, you know. Is it true what they say about the Swedes?
Inga har glagat. Jag tror jag vet vad du har till kärna. Kommer I sovmet så skulle jag visa vad jag menar. Jag svär på att du kommer aldrig att glömma det.
I like the way you make a moves, Frank. No better way to soften a deal than with a dame in a bed.
You're getting along pretty good with the big boy, aren't you, Frank?
Just trying to get along, Angelo. Just trying to get along with everybody.
Hello.
Hello, Polly. How are you?
Hello, Casey. I'm fine, just fine. Where are you? I can hardly hear you.
I just jumped off the train to make this call. We're coming off the road for the show.
I'll see you in New York in a couple of days. Can you hear me?
I said I'll see you when I get into town. I can't talk. I have to run. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
So long, Polly.
He's coming back.
Yes.
You really like that guy. Oh, it's ridiculous. I hardly even know him. He knows even less about me.
Long enough to forget.
You don't have to go to bed with them. Feel their ugly bodies. I'm a whore.
You're a sick girl. You're sick, but you gotta kick it, or I can't keep you here, honey. I can't. You gotta fight it. We'll help you, honey, but you've gotta fight. It's the only way.
No, I've got to have it! I need it!
What is it, Madge?
What? Sure, baby.
About it. Why'd you hide it from me?
She begged me, Polly, not to tell you. She was afraid you'd throw her out.
Where does she get the stuff? Who supplies her with it?
She picked up with some musician, a saxophone player at some dance hall she'd go to.
What's his name?
Dixie.
Dixie what?
That's what she always called him. She's crazy about him, Polly. He's the one that got her on it. Polly, she begged me not to tell you. I've been going through hell. Absolute hell.
All right. Now listen. Not a word of this to Frank or any of the others. I couldn't keep her here for 10 minutes if they found out about it.
Okay, Polly.
Here's an address I got on him. Down in the village.
Thank you.
Look, Case, I don't like to spread gossip about other musicians, but this guy is a junkie. He's a real bad boy. He goes from trouble to trouble. Now, what is he to you?
All right, Polly. Now you know where to find Dixie Keeler. Now, what's it all about?
Do you remember Madge Donnelly, the pretty little brunette from the Nonpareil? She used to win all the Charleston contests.
Yeah.
That's what it's all about.
You see what I mean? He's put a lot of kids on the stuff. Dixie's the kind of a junkie who likes company.
Thanks. Thank you, Casey. I don't want you to get mixed up in this.
Thanks for everything, Gabe. Thank you.
Casey, I got two words for you. Look out.
We heard your horn. The door was open.
looking for Madge, Dixie. Dixie, is she here?
He's in another world. You play real fine horn, Dixie. I blow on myself, so I know. Yeah, that's it. It's a good sound, Dixie. You play the truth. That's why. Nobody can do better than that. A man has got to feel the truth to play that good. Yeah, that's a real fine sound, Dixie. A real fine sound.
Casey, she hasn't made the slightest kind of a move.
Oh, she doesn't even look like the same girl.
Oh, she's sick. She's so sick.
Look, let's get to a doctor fast.
I can't play that horn anymore. I can't make that note a high sound. I can't make that high sound.
We're taking Madge out, Dixie. She needs help.
If I could get up high on that cloud.
Madge is sick, Dixie. We've got to get her to a doctor.
You can't make me play. I'm not going to blow that horn.
Look out!
It's an overdose. She's too far gone.
Oh, no. No.
We can't bring her out of it. Her respiratory system had been damaged. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Doctor.
Matt. Poor, beautiful Matt.
Propels a girl into this short and miserable life. The greatest single factor is poverty. But there is more than one kind of poverty. When there's lack of education and of love, there's lack of hope. And out of such impoverishment, the prostitute is born. The night Madge died, Casey was gentle and understanding. And as we walked through Central Park, I knew I was hopelessly in love with him.
Did you ever stop to think that maybe there's nothing to be sad about when somebody dies?
What?
Somehow, it seems to me that we don't know enough about life to be sad about death.
You know, you live in a wonderful world. A world completely full of the joy of living.
Living is my favorite pastime.
Casey, you know, you are the happiest person I ever met.
Polly, what would you say if I told you I was falling in love with you?
What, are you serious?
Sure I'm serious.
Casey, can't we just be good friends, Casey?
Is there someone else?
No.
Then what?
Don't ask me any more questions. You know, life is one big happy event for you. I've never even seen your wonderful world. World without any fear, without any worry. Don't talk about it anymore.
Everything about you tells me that you want me. I know you want me.
Casey. Madge wasn't the fun-loving girl you remember from the nonpareil. She was a prostitute. I'm not the naive girl you protected the first night we met.
Come on. I'll take you home.
I'm a madam.
What kind of crack is that?
You heard me. I run a house of prostitution. Beautiful Madge on Long Island. Lorraine, myself, and a few of the other girls were the only ones who attended the funeral. As we stood by the grave, none of us wanted to think of our own futures. And I never heard any of them mention Madge's name again.
Possibly give us a lift.
Well, Manhattan is just where we're going. It would be our pleasure.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Hop in, young ladies. No telling when that train will get here. You know, young ladies like you shouldn't be out without protection. And I'm just the man you need. Police Inspector Henry J. Muldoon at your service.
Police Inspector? How nice. That's just what we need.
Well, what could such lovely ladies as you be doing so far out here all by yourselves?
Oh, we're a group of school teachers on our weekly field trip, nature study.
School teachers? Of what school?
Polytech. Oh. Hello, Frank.
Polly, I'd like you to know Bill Cameron.
Bill Cameron? Oh, I look this way when I'm impressed. The tabloids refer to you as the city's most famous trial lawyer. It's very good to know you.
I hope my notoriety doesn't preclude me from your hospitality, Miss Adler.
Oh, of course not. Shall we start with a drink?
Scott Strait, Bill wants to arrange a private party, and he'd like our friend from Tammany Hall invited.
Oh, I'm sure that can be arranged.
No party was ever spoiled by having pretty girls around. And few deals ever suffered from having pleasant company for the dealers. Thanks.
Well, 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 this must be the place.
Casey, who let you in? Why are you here?
That's an asinine question if I ever heard one. Why would anybody come to a cat house?
You're drunk.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know. I didn't realize you were so prudish. I apologize. But now, let's get down to business. Would you be good enough to show me your merchandise?
Casey, would you get out of here, please? Get out of here.
Get out of here? Why? Tell me, madam. And I use the term advisedly. Isn't my money as good as these gentlemen's? I'm willing to pay the going rate. Isn't that what you're here for, madam?
Don't you think you're getting a little out of line, young man?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know. Have they recently written a book of etiquette for whorehouses?
All right, we'll do it your way. What do you want?
That's better. That's more like it. Now we're getting someplace. I must say, you have quite a variety. I find it hard to make a choice. Knowing my taste as you do, won't you help me make a selection? I'm in the market for a luxury rather than a utility. Say something like, that fine little piece over here.
All right, Jeanette.
Do I have it here, or do I take it with me?
Whatever you want.
That's as far as it goes. Sober him up.
No, Frank! Kate, oh, no! No, no!
Get him out of here.
Casey!
Get away from me. Don't come near me.
Thank you.
Polly.
Good morning. Hey, John, did you get my new gown?
I got everything. When I promise you something, I don't forget. Johnny brings you everything. There we are.
Oh, I want to see it.
Oh, one. Hello, baby. One free in the evening gown, size 12.
That's mine.
$99.50 in the store. You, $50.
Oh.
Hey, don't get any rouge on that. Keep it away from your face. Aha. Look at this beautiful black negligee.
What about my silver fox scarf?
Dear, I'll bring it to you on my next visit. You know when I promise you something, you'll get it. All you do is ask Charlie what you want. I get it, I sell it.
This was ordered by a customer that works in another joint. establishment.
Is this stuff pure silk?
Hey, what do you think? You're dealing with a schlock joint? Look, I got the best shoplifters in town working for me. They wouldn't know how to steal from a cheap place.
Charlie. All right, girls, girls.
Polly. Reardon's here. Back door.
Backdoor Reardon. I think his idea of a party is to take up a collection.
Oh, no, it's for me. No,
it's it, girl.
Oh, it's my girl.
Oh, good morning, gentlemen. Am I interrupting anything?
This is Pete Snyder. Pete's from downtown headquarters.
Hello, Pete. Here, I have my Easter contribution ready. Sorry, I plan to have it wrapped.
We got something else in mind. One of the boys just got promoted to lieutenant, and we want to throw a shindig for him at your place. No outsiders, understand?
Yeah, I understand.
You know, some of the other queen bees would be tickled to death to have the party at their house, even if it isn't a cuffo. But since you got the nod, I know that you'd see that everything is Park Avenue.
Tell me, how many in your party?
Well, 12, maybe 15.
12, 15? Reardon, maybe I ought to have a green light outside.
I told you, he's got a hell of a sense of humor.
I'll give you a call when we pick out the night.
Reardon, you know, I've greased that palm of yours so often. Be careful the phone doesn't slip out of your hand.
What'd I tell you?
You know something? We're going to reserve you for the lieutenant. You're just his type.
You better inform your friend about the function of a madam.
You should be on it. Lieutenant's a great guy, and besides, he's going to be the new boss around here.
Well, how marvelous. He's your lieutenant. Why don't you sleep with him?
I got the word. Tammany's putting O'Brien up for district attorney. That's what I've been waiting for. In 6 months, no ship gets unloaded unless Luciano says it gets unloaded. I'm leaving for Chicago tonight. I got a few details to work out. Those shipping companies have 100 years of influence behind them, reaching from the state capital to Washington. I need some influence in my pocket to even up the odds. Frank, I've decided to put you on top of this. He's the best man for it, Angelo.
Anything you say, Charlie.
But I want things done so no roads lead to Luciano. Yeah?
Your car's waiting downstairs. You just have time to make your train.
Okay.
You handle things in your own style, Frank. You got good style.
Those ship owners aren't just Sunday fighters. They didn't get where they are hanging around a country club.
I understand. No roads lead to Luciano. Harrigan, we offered $20,000 for the judgeship. You've had weeks to make up your mind. Why can't we get on with the deal?
Well, the boys down at the hall, they figure a judgeship is worth $30,000.
All right, Mr. Cameron, we'll pay $30,000, no more.
All right, then the transaction's closed.
Hmm.
Suppose we say $5,000 now and the rest when you deliver the judgeship.
I wouldn't do that if I were you. In a deal like this, we don't want our names on any pieces of paper. Polly, show them how we operate.
$5,000. I put the money where your mouth is.
Thank you.
Later, I just add it to your bill.
Well, you've been to the whole place, haven't you?
All right, everybody, quiet down. I want you to meet his honor, Judge William Cameron.
Oh,
I got the drink.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Judge, congratulations, sir. Going to be more deals made at Polly Adler's than City Hall. Get yourself a new place, more class over on the east side.
Who knows, you might be entertaining the mayor himself.
I moved up and over to the east side. I entertained business tycoons, intellectuals, and men in high positions in the government. It seemed that sex was a common denominator for all strata of society.
You have a visitor, Polly.
Who?
Backdoor Reardon.
Sergeant Reardon. Haven't seen him in a long time. This isn't his district. I wonder what ill wind blew him over here.
Well, 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 Sergeant Reardon. I haven't seen you in a long, long time. Hello, fellas. What brings you over to this neighborhood?
Well, I've been transferred to the 4th Division. You know what? You're my first official call. This is a classy joint you moved into.
Oh, Johnny, you mustn't call this a joint.
This is a Class A, number one house of assignation.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. Now I can achieve my life's ambition.
Well, more power to you, dear. And what's your life's ambition?
To raid Polly Adler. That's my life's ambition.
Oh, no, no. I've been making my regular payoffs.
Well, that has nothing to do with it. You see, your newspaper copy now. When Polly Adler's is raided, it'll make headlines. And my new boss goes for headlines. And he goes to bat for the boys that grab more for him, too. So when I look at you, Polly, I'm looking at a promotion.
Oh, come on, Johnny. You mustn't scare me like this. You sound like a cop I don't know.
Tonight I am a cop you don't know.
Oh, just a minute. I'll get that little tin box.
Save yourself some time now. Will I tell your guests, or will you break it to them gently?
Johnny, after all the money I've given you and the others all these years...
Then how would you like your ride, Your Highness? In a patrol wagon or in a private car? Ha, 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 ha!
For myself. I'd line them up.
Okay, boys.
Let's go. Come on. Come on.
Let's go.
Come on. Come on.
Come on.
Come on. Come on. Line them up.
Over there. Come on.
Come on over
there.
Hold it, Fatso. No, you don't. This is a raid.
Inspector Muldoon.
Who the hell are you?
Sergeant Reardon of the 4th Division.
Who ordered this raid?
It was my own idea, sir.
Oh, it was your own idea. All right, Patrolman Reardon. Tell your captain I want him in my office first thing in the morning.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me, miss. Yes, sir. Fire the raid off. Let's go. Come on. Come on, I changed my mind. Keep moving.
Goodbye, Reardon. As might be expected, the worst time of all was the big holidays. Christmas, a man goes home to his family. New Year's, he goes out with his wife. There was nothing to help the girls with the painful awareness that they couldn't go home ever. Youth, their only capital, was dwindling away. Our only male guest was Father Time, unseen, but very much present.
Okay.
Oh, I'll get it.
This New Year's Eve broadcast is coming to you from the Pennsylvania Room.
Holly Adler? Yes, that's me.
Well, I guess you heard of Hattie Miller.
Hattie Miller? Of course I've heard of Hattie Miller. Come on in. Hello.
Holly, these are some of my girls, Dolly, Braithwaite, and Suzanne.
Hello, girls.
You know, we were going to celebrate New Year's Eve at my place, and I figured, why not get in the spirit of things? Share the goodwill with some of my competitors. So we've been making the rounds.
Well, that's more than Macy's does for Gimbel's. Come on in, girls. Join the party. Girls, I want you to meet the Hattie Miller. And this is Darlene, Suzanne, Bertha. Girls, introduce yourselves.
Come Hello, on. Girls. Look at this place. Isn't this magnificent? Just magnificent. And you're the well-known Polly Adler. Polly, meeting you late is better than never. You know, it's a pleasure to get out of my house. Nobody's ever going to come to visit us tonight anyway. So I says to the girls, let's all go out on the town. Let's have our own party, I says.
Come on, have some champagne, hmm?
Oh, no champagne for me. Takes too long to make you happy, Polly, not me. This is the stuff I drink. See that? You know, one of my customers makes this himself. A couple of belts and wow. It's one hell of a time coming upstairs.
I'd have something to eat, Hattie, huh?
Girls, did you ever see a spread like this? Just look at it. You know, I do all the cooking in my place. Never let any of the girls get into the kitchen. I always say, too many cooks spoil the brothel.
All the raids and shakedowns lately and the high overhead, I'm always ending up on the opposite side of the ledger. You know, I operate now with four partners, the landlord, the hoods, the politicians, and the police. Eddie, tell me something. Why can't we get out of this lousy business?
Yeah, like everybody says to me. Eddie, you got plenty of money. You're getting old. Why are you still a madam?
Why am I still a madam?
You know why, Polly? Because who the hell wants to visit an ex-madam, huh? You tell me now. And I don't want to die of loneliness.
T.S. Who the hell wants to hear your life story?
Lorraine, shut up.
Do you really think we're going to have a good time tonight? Are we all here to celebrate or to help each other forget?
Cut it out. Now, come on, this is a party.
Who are we kidding? Hear them out there with their wives and families. Now tell me something. What have we got to celebrate about?
Lauren, take it easy. Come on, remember, it's New Year's Eve.
That's right. This is New Year's Eve. The lousiest night of the year for us. How do you celebrate the lousiest night of the year? What resolutions should we make? What plans for the future? Ha! Tonight just reminds us that we're gonna spend 365 more days as hookers. Hear them out there? They're all waiting for New Year's. And we'd like to stop the clock. Better yet, Polly. Back.
Just seconds to the new year, folks. 3, 2, 1. Happy New Year!
New Year.
Extra, read all about it. Lucky Luciano and prostitution racket. Extra, read all about it.
I tell you this, Dewey, can't tie me in with prostitution. What have I got to do with prostitution? He's just shaking off some headlines, that's what he's doing. That's all there is to it.
Don't underestimate Dewey. He means business, Charlie, and you're going to have to appear before that grand jury.
Somebody's given Dewey faked up evidence. I'm in the clear, I tell you. It's the power play. They're trying to push me down. Yeah?
Mr. Costigan is here.
Send him in. Just when I've got every doc in the city in my fist, they smear me across the papers like some cheap pimp. Go on, tell them.
Dewey claims there'll be an army of witnesses. Prostitutes, madams, who'll testify they've been making payoffs under threats of violence. He also claims the witnesses link the payoffs to Luciano. There are over 70 counts in the complaint.
It's a smokescreen. He can't make it stick.
Don't bet on it. This action was initiated by Governor Lehman himself. I'll be in my office if you want me, Charlie.
I never had a hustler work for me in my life.
If this isn't a frame and they've got witnesses like they say, I've been set up. If somebody in our organization is shaking down the whorehouses in this city, I'm in big trouble. Because even if I don't know anything about it, what chance have I got against Dewey before a jury? Now, who could that be, Frank?
I haven't the slightest idea, Charlie.
Frank, I put a lot of trust in you. My judgment better be good. Where's Polly?
In the library.
Get her. Come on, out, out.
What's that? You take
Katie. Everybody, get her.
What are you doing?
Come on, you're going out. Make sure you're not
around.
What's up?
Frank, what the hell are you doing?
I'm going to ask you a straight question, and I want a straight answer.
Yeah, sure, Frank. Sure.
Are you being shaken down?
Now, come on, are you kidding? I contribute to the bank accounts of half the cops in New York City.
Don't play cute. You read the papers. I want an answer. Are the joy houses of this town being shaken down?
Frank, this is one thing you leave me out of.
Answer me.
Frank, come on. I'm scared of death. The girls have been constantly threatened. Two of Hattie Miller's girls were badly beaten up.
Who's behind the shakedown?
I don't know. I don't want to know. I don't ask.
Talk.
All right. Angela's brother picks up the money every week.
Angelo's brother. Why didn't you tell me?
What for? I've been a fall guy for that mob so long I feel like a rubber ball.
Did you believe Charlie Lucky was behind it?
What the hell difference would I believe, Frank? What could I do about it if he was? What can I do about Charlie Lucky? For that matter, what can I do about you, Frank? Call the police? How do I fight back, Frank? With what? What else do you want from me? What else?
It was your brother who set up Lucky. He's a real crafty one, Angelo. Everybody knows he works for the outfit, so all he had to do was keep his mouth shut, and they'd go on believing that he was collecting for Luciano. He gave Dewey just the opening he needed to nail Charlie.
And you just sit there and listen to him. You just sit there and let him put me down, huh? All right, Frank. I listened. Now, I'm through listening. You don't like my brother? All right. But don't push it too hard.
Angelo.
I don't want to hear anymore. It makes me sick inside just to hear somebody even thinks it.
Bring her in. Both sides of her face used to be pretty. Remember her, Vince? She remembers you. Try telling her Luciano didn't put him up to it. Try to make her believe it. Take her home.
You believe that? You believe him?
Do you want me to bring down some more, Angelo?
Vince, you did this to Charlie?
Stay out of it, Angelo. Don't mix it and don't try anything.
You put a guy like Charlie Lucky in a spot like this? You louse up a guy who's been so good to me?
You don't push me around anymore, Angelo.
This is my own deal. It's got nothing to do with you. Angelo's brother, Angelo's brother. Like I ain't got a name. Well, I got a name from now on.
Yeah? You're a lousy, no good pimp!
Don't, Angelo. I'm telling you, don't.
Easy, Angelo. He means it.
You ain't got the guts. You ain't got the guts!
Believe it. Oh, darling, it's so good to hear your voice again. Listen, how are you? Where are you?
Well, I thought you'd come to Vito's. Remember the old Italian restaurant? Just for old time's sake, Pa.
Oh, will I ever be there? You just say when, honey.
Tonight. What about tonight?
Well, tonight, that's wonderful. What time?
Oh, Polly, you know, I'm married now. I have a baby, and my husband, he's kind of strict. I'm only telling you this so you'll understand.
Now, Sidonia...
Remember now, Vito's 7 o'clock. Bye, Polly.
Hello, Harry. Did you remember me? I'm Polly Adler.
Yeah, I know who you are. Sidonia isn't coming. And another thing, if her husband should ever find out that she knows you, he might get ideas, you know?
I don't understand this. Why'd she phone me? What is this all about?
Follow me, please.
Casey.
How are you?
Fine. I'm fine.
Would you like to sit down?
Certainly. Did you have Sidonia call me?
Yeah, I was afraid you wouldn't come if I phoned myself.
Where have you been?
I've been on the road most of the time, different clubs, different bands.
It's very good to see you. Are you back in New York on business?
No. I came back to see you. Polly, I've never forgiven myself for the way I acted that night. The things I said to you, you leveled with me. You never lied to me once. You didn't have it coming to you.
Well, let's not relive it all now, huh?
Look, Polly, are you awfully angry?
I don't think I could eat a thing.
Let's get out of here, huh? I can't tell you how many times I started to come back to New York. I just couldn't forget you. Polly, I can't fight it forever. Tonight I sat and waited for you to come in, nervous as a school kid on his first date. Not knowing what you'd say when you saw me. Polly, that night that I acted like such a heel, you must have known it was because I loved you.
I've loved you too, Casey.
I still hate what you stand for. I still despise what you're doing. But I'm still in love with you, and there's nothing that I can do about it. Polly, marry me.
Oh, Casey. Only you and your never, never land could believe such a thing was possible. People just wouldn't let it happen, Casey.
They would never let you forget that you were married to Madame Polly Adler.
We'll go someplace where nobody knows us. Nobody to point fingers at us. Nobody to call names.
Casey, I just don't know.
Look, Polly, I've come back. I came back because I love you. Isn't that enough?
Casey, don't you think I want to believe it? That I want to think it's so? I just don't know. I'm confused. And afraid.
We've got one lifetime, one lifetime. And there's not that much happiness around that we can throw ours away.
Hello, Frank.
Sit down, Polly. Charlie Lucky was indicted this morning by the grand jury on 61 counts. Looks like Luciano's through. Looks like Dewey will get him. Meanwhile, the organization wants me to look after things. I'm expecting some of the big boys in from Chicago in a few days. I want to throw a party. It's important to me.
Frank, Casey Booth came back. He wants me to marry him.
You haven't got a chance in hell.
Well, Frank, please. Please, let me go.
I'm not stopping you, Polly. I'd like to see you make it, but you just can't. You can't cross the line back. It can't be done.
Oh, listen. We'll go someplace where nobody knows us.
It has nothing to do with anyone else. Doesn't matter where you go. You can go to the moon. It won't do any good. Casey Booth knows. He'll always know.
Frank, he loves me.
Then don't kill the guy for it. You've been a madam. You've sold flesh. They haven't invented anything to wash that away. They never will. If you go away with that guy, you'll destroy him. I know what that would do to you if you did. Look, Polly, we both know how you got started. Don't forget, I was there in the beginning.
I made the decision, nobody else. But no matter how it happened, there's nothing that can be done about it now, Frank. That's it, isn't it? Don't try to cross the line back, because nobody can forgive what I've done. They'll forgive a thief or a prostitute, maybe even a murderess, but nobody will forgive a procuress. Not even you, Frank. Not even the man who loves me. For all these years, I've helped other women degrade and sell themselves. In the lucrative business of supplying the appetites of men, I've corrupted my own womanhood. Whatever the reasons for my original ignorant decision, my subsequent fear and greed destroyed me. In my house filled with people, I pin my diamonds on loneliness and despair, and I will never have a home.
Polly. It's Casey Booth again. Better talk to him.
Hello? Hello, Casey. Listen, we can't go through with it. No, darling, it just wouldn't work. Well, maybe next time around I catch the ring. I'll get to the Golden of Medina. Oh, Casey, the way you look at things is not the way they are. What I've done in my life can't be worried away between 2 and 3 on a Thursday afternoon. Casey? Don't be sad about it. Remember what you told me? We don't know enough about life to be sad about that. Goodbye, Casey. Goodbye.